it's a long-standing event, and we're glad to continue the tradition. This year with some support from the Rotman Institute as well. And we're extremely pleased to have a great lineup of speakers to celebrate the 100th anniversary of General Relativity this year. And so without further ado, I would like to introduce our first speaker, John Norton from the University of Pittsburgh, who will tell us about how the theory was discovered. John.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here. Let me get down to business. Okay, so I'll start out with a bit of scene setting and then tell you the specific piece that I'm going to talk about. So Einstein's discovery of general relativity was a long process. It began in 1907, went through a first phase in which he built up to a novel theory of static gravitational fields, which is rarely talked about. I'm going to talk a bit about it because it's not normally talked about. It's in that development that he hit upon the principle of equivalence, which was his major heuristic device. Then comes the big transition. He moves to Zurich from Prague and begins a collaboration with Marcel Grossmann. This is where they get the idea that the absolute differential calculus of Ricci and Levi-Civita is the key to moving forward. In more modern terms, you get the idea of gravity connected with the curvature of space-time. Then in 1913, you get the first sketch of the general theory of relativity. This is the theory, this is the sketch that has all of the theory present, but not the final gravitational field equations. And then Einstein struggles for several years until completing the theory in November of 1915. And the centerpiece of that completion is his recognition that the new theory picks up exactly the anomalous motion of Mercury, probably the greatest moment of Einstein's scientific life. Okay, so that's the theme we'll be talking about. It's 7 or 8 years of intense work by Einstein at the peak of his creative powers. Now, when you come to speak to an audience that has philosophers in it, there's a tremendous number of issues that you could talk about, and it really was a problem to figure out what I wouldn't talk about. So I made up a bit of a list of things that we could talk about in discussion afterwards. For philosophers in particular, there's a question of what are the founding principles of the theory? Is he generalizing the principle of relativity, Marx's principle, absolutes, a whole bunch of stuff there. Then you might get interested in what went wrong in the summer of 1912, 1913, where he gets turned away from from general covariance. You might want to talk about coordinate systems. It's something that turns out to have been a very delicate thing for Einstein to get clear on exactly what is the physical significance of them. That was a big problem. What about alternative theories? Einstein was working with Nordstrom on a very different sort of theory at the same time. All of these things are interesting to talk about. There are things that can be said about Einstein's way of thinking. He was quite conscious of his methodology, and he separated what he called mathematical and physical thinking. And as a result of this episode, he became a mathematical Platonist. I thought that might interest some people if it's maybe the most prominent mathematical Platonist of the 20th century, quite outspoken about it. We could say something about empirical testing, about which I know a little less. Or we could talk about the ways that Einstein generated his gravitational field equations. And I thought I would talk about that, because it's less talked about. There's actually quite a story there. You can look under the hood and see what Einstein was doing when he was building these equations. Something like general relativity, something as complicated as general relativity, doesn't just spring fully formed into your head, even if you're Einstein. You actually consciously have methods and techniques. And I want to talk about one of those techniques, because it's interesting. Well, you'll see how it goes. All right, so that's going to be the goal. I want to talk about the method that Einstein used to generate gravitational field equations. And you can tell a story of the evolution of the method, starting out with something very simple and gradually getting more and more complicated until you have a method of sufficient power to do what we do nowadays. So let me get started. Where does special relativity begin? Well, special relativity begins with a conflict between Newtonian gravitation theory and special relativity. The sun in Newtonian theory has an instantaneous gravitational effect on the sun. its effect propagates instantaneously to us, and we feel the force of the sun at the same moment as the sun emanates it, if that's a way of talking. And that, of course, contradicts what you're getting in the special theory of relativity, where influences are propagating only at the speed of light. So after the special theory of relativity is set up in 1905, there's some work to be done, that is to reconcile Newtonian gravitation theory and Einstein's special theory of relativity. Einstein doesn't do much about that for a while. The occasion for him to do that was this guy, Johannes Stark, who was the editor of this journal, commissioned him in 1907 to write a review article on the principle of relativity. The principle of relativity being the term that was used for what we now call the theory of relativity. And so that issued in this paper, a review article written at the end of the year on the principle of relativity and the consequences that follow from it. It's an interesting glimpse into the behind-the-scenes life of Einstein when you look at the correspondence between them. Having taken on this commission, he then has to write back to Johannes Stark the following remark. This is Einstein posing at a Stehtisch, which is one of those standing desks that they were using at the patent office where he was working. And he's saying here, it's sort of sad, right? I'm not able to acquaint myself with everything published on the subject because the library is closed during my free time. You would therefore do me a great favor if you could bring to my attention other publications if you know of any. So I think it's fair to say that almost everyone in the room has more favorable working conditions than did Einstein at this particular time. Okay, so what comes out of this is quite extraordinary. Einstein works through the various branches of physics, showing how they are compatible with the special theory of relativity. Obviously, electrodynamics, there's no problem, it's already relativized, that's where the Lorentz transformation comes from. Mechanics, not terribly hard. He invents relativistic thermodynamics, and then comes to gravity, right, and convinces himself fairly rapidly of something extraordinary. Right, and that is that there's no way to do it. You cannot combine special relativity and Newtonian gravitation theory without doing something really major. Right, now this flew in the face of the wisdom at the time. Both Poincaré and Minkowski had in effect said in modern language, it's easy to get a Lorentz covariant version of Newtonian theory, just add a few terms, you'll get very slight differences, second order corrections, no big deal, what's the fuss? Einstein came to the conclusion that that was just not right, right? Very, very early on. Now, what was the problem? Well, the problem went back to Galileo. This is Galileo's law of fall. You know the law. It says all bodies fall alike, independently of their masses. There's a nice little picture that shows it to you. There's another version of that was essential to Galileo's law and of the fall, and that is that the vertical acceleration, the vertical motion of fall, is independent of the sideways motion. So if you take these, you know, this is a caricature of what really happened. He did not take a cannon and put it up on top of the block, right? You know that. And you let one drop and you give the others some sideways motion, right? Then they will fall vertically in an equal motion and strike the ground at the same time. What Einstein found when he started to write down the natural Lorentz covariant laws of gravity was that this result failed. The vertical fall of a body would depend upon its horizontal motion. Now everyone knew that at the time, but the effects are so small, second order small in B and C, that they assumed they didn't matter, so don't fuss with it. It's a little hard now to understand why this bothered Einstein so much that he was willing to launch off in a completely new direction. I think one of the clues is this. He said that it would mean that hot bodies and cold bodies would fall differently, because inside the bodies you have rapid motions, and these motions would then cause a problem. So Einstein was kind of stuck. He didn't believe that any Lorentz covariant theory was going to work. What could you do? So for him, the key innovation at this point was methodological. He found a way of breaking through the problem. And that way of breaking through the problem is what he later called the happiest thought of my life. Right? And this is the thought. It's the principle of equivalence. And let me act out for you the way that it works. Let's take those three masses that we had at the top of the tower, But we're now going to locate them in a distant part of space where, say, special relativity holds and there's no gravity. And we'll give these two masses sideways motion, but not this one. And then we're going to view them from a uniformly accelerated frame of reference. That's this box here, which is going to move upwards, as you will see in a moment if you attend carefully. See? Right. So it goes up. So what does the observer inside this box see? Right. Well, the observer inside the box finds the masses to be falling vertically in exactly the way that he wanted them to fall. Right. In other words, to escape this violation of the of Galileo's result about falling bodies. Right. So then the postulate simply becomes this, that the two cases here are the same. That if you what you see around you, if you put yourself in a box and accelerate uniformly upwards, what you see in space around you is exactly the same thing as a homogeneous gravitational field. The figure here is misleading because the Earth doesn't produce a homogeneous field, but you get the idea. Okay, so that's the postulate. What does Einstein do with it? The key thing is it's a heuristic postulate. Right? What he now has in this box is a single example of a relativistically clean gravitational field that conforms with Galileo's requirements. He's got just one case. Right? And the further development of the theory simply consists of taking that as a specimen, right, and examining its properties and generalizing them appropriately. Those of you who do particle physics might be wondering, this sounds vaguely familiar. This is, in fact, the first example of the gauge argument. Right? If you transform yourself over to that, this is actually the template for the gauge argument. It isn't obvious until you crank the wheels, but it's there. All right. So the results then come pouring out. Just redo the experiment, this time with the beam of light, and so the beam of light is going to be bent by a gravitational field. Same story. Or put clocks in the box here, higher and higher and lower, remembering you're in special relativity, not necessarily in Newtonian space. And if you're in a special relativistic space, Minkowski space-time did not quite exist yet. So, then you will discover that the clock that's deeper in the resulting gravitational field is going to be slowed. This then gives Einstein the relativistic the gravitational slowing of clocks. And the redshift effect of light from the sun, all of this happening in 1907 in that original paper. And then finally, the speed of light itself is slowed down in a gravitational field. I'll give you a number of examples here. So the speed at which light propagates remains isotropic in space. The speed in this particular field, though, becomes proportional to distance. The deeper you are in the field, linearly, the slower the light gets, and in effect, C becomes the new gravitational potential. Right? You have a homogeneous field, so the field is going to vary linearly with distance in the field. C is doing that. C becomes your new gravitational potential. So this then becomes the basis of the development of this theory of static gravitational fields. What's the static about? It's the fields that would be produced by masses at rest. We don't have anything like gravitational waves, nothing like that. We're just trying to get the static part of this sorted out. That's what he's looking at in this time. So this is the paper from 1907. Einstein gets very distracted by the problems of quantum and stops working on general relativity. Comes back to it in 1911 because he now realizes that the bending of light by gravitational field can be empirically tested at an eclipse, and so he tries to get that done, and then reworks the theory, makes it a little more elegant. This is the paper that appears in that little blue Dover volume. It's a lovely little paper, but it's not a good representation of the theory that he was building up to. That theory is this one here, that the speed of light in static gravitational fields. This was received on the 26th of February in 1912, and that carries through the program of taking what you see in this uniformly accelerated frame and generalizing it in appropriate ways to get a theory of static gravitational fields. So let me talk about what I'll call version version one of the theory. This is how it looks. In a homogeneous gravitational field, to rough approximation, the fall of a body will be something like a parabola. Those of you who know some general relativity, think Rindler coordinates, right? It's all Rindler coordinates, if you know what they are. But this is the first approximation to them. It's sort of parabola-like. It's one case. You want to find a differential equation to which that conforms, which will be your law of force that will apply to all cases. And it's not hard for Einstein to write down the law. It's this equation here, which he's written here as well. That's a little bit complicated. It's got the usual sorts of relativistic corrections. Vq is just the speed, so these are the gamma factors that you see. The case that's easiest to see clearly, and the case that we will worry about, is this one. Take the case of a mass that is momentarily at rest, in other words, q equals zero, then the general equation reduces to this. The acceleration, mass times the time derivative, second time derivative of position, is minus m the mass again, and then the x component of the gradient, right? Very familiar looking equation. This is sort of, you know, he's got this y right here in the principle of equivalence, and then he proceeds to crank out very ordinary sorts of field theoretic notions, making the most conservative sorts of generalizations. Correspondingly, we're looking for a field equation. So he's got the speed of light varies linearly with distance. X direction is the direction of the field. What is the general field equation to which that linear dependence conforms? Well, if you know any field theory, you'll know it's obvious there's only one equation that is the natural one. You simply write down the vanishing of the Laplacian. This is the solution of that. Right? And that's looking very much like ordinary Newtonian theory. What about adding in sources? No problem. You just add a source term over here. And that then becomes his gravitational field equation. Okay. So I want to emphasize here, this is looking very, very standard at this point. It's almost exactly like electrostatics, except with some obvious relativistic corrections. There are one or two differences here, because we're now dealing with a relativistic space-time, but this is the way that the corresponding equations look for Newtonian gravity or Coulomb electrostatics. I hope that everyone's familiar with them. You've seen them before. This is what Einstein's equations look like if we limit ourselves to the case of bodies at rest. Now, there's one difference that's going to turn out to be really important. You have a gauge freedom for the potentials here that is an additive term. They're determined up to an additive constant. The speed of light, Einstein says, is determined up to a multiplicative constant. You change your units of measurement and the speed of light changes accordingly. So you don't want that equation. That's where this C over here is coming from on the right-hand side, the only really major difference. And looking ahead, that is going to be a big deal. Right? Just foreshadowing what's going to happen. That's going to be a really big deal. Now, in case you're wondering what's happened, there's a simple geometric picture for what's going on here. Einstein did not have this geometric picture when he started out. He did very shortly. It's coming. But in effect, this is his theory. You take a space-time. This is the line element of the space-time. There exists a coordinate system in which that is the invariant interval. And you can read off its geometric properties very easily. You have orthogonal hypersurfaces here. Orthogonal to the time-like trajectories, and the spaces are Euclidean. So you have a Euclidean space here on the slices. This is going to matter much for other issues that I won't talk about. And then over here, all the possible deviations from Minkowski spacetime reside in that function C. If you make that function C depend linearly on the coordinates, you're back in Minkowski spacetime. If you have another dependence, you've now moved into a curved space-time. So this is the metric written out in component terms, and free falls turn out to be geodesics in space-time metric. And he didn't have that at the time, but I know when I was working through the history of this, I'm wondering, what is this theory, right? You've got C there, and it's variable, and I was trying to get a sort of an intuitive grasp of what it's all about. So everything looks fine, right? what can go wrong, right? Something that people were saying around that time, somewhere else. It's 1912, and that's what they were saying here, right? What can go wrong? Well, this is the interesting thing. It had already gone wrong, and Einstein knew it. This is a page from the paper. Here you see the two field equations that I described for you, and here's a footnote. And this is what the footnote says. In a work shortly to follow, it will be shown that the equations 5a and 5b cannot be exactly right. In this work, they use provisionally. So he knew he had a really serious problem. This is muted language, so he's not telling you. It's basically, you know, sometimes when you work on a paper and you think you've got it all worked out and everything's just fine, and then you just look back and you have this holy wow moment when you suddenly realize it's wrong. It's wrong, and why didn't I see it? Well, that's what's just happened here. He's had one of those moments, and so my God, he's got to get this footnote in quickly to tell people, no, this is not the right equation. So, all right, what's going on? This is the paper that he sends in a month later, right? That's why I was stressing the date. 26th of February was the early one. This now comes in March. And then he explains what's gone wrong, what the big problem is. Here's the text in which he's doing the explaining. He has discovered that his theory is in contradiction with the principle of equality of action and reaction. In modern language, we might say momentum is not conserved. This is bad. Figure that out. And so how does that work out? The totality of masses located in space considered, which we will think of as fixed to a rigid massless frame, will seek to set themselves in motion. So here's the picture. Here's just a few masses. They're connected together by rigid rods, right? And each mass exerts a gravitational force on the other, an attractive force. So there's, so you can add up all these forces, and what you hope is they all add up to zero and everything's fine. Einstein finds they don't add up to zero. You've got a non-zero net force on the system. So that's what the frame is going to do. It's going to spontaneously set itself into motion. All right, so what was the problem? Well, this was the problem. This is the force density on a mass distribution rho, sigma rather. He used rho in the last paper. He's now switched to sigma. We can cope, can we not? Right, so sigma is just mass density. You take that force density, and then you just integrate it over your mass distribution. It's a simple, easy integral to do. And you discover the guy doesn't vanish. Right, it's a quite straightforward calculation to do. All right, so Einstein's got a big problem. In the paper, he actually goes through a whole bunch of different possibilities for how you might repair the damage and concludes this one doesn't work, and this one doesn't work, and this one doesn't work. But there's one that does work. It works beautifully. So let me show you what it is. Now, first, a little warm-up. It's Einstein's theory that has the problem. Einstein's theory is formally very close to Coulomb electrostatic and Newton's gravitation, right? Those theories don't have the problem. Why don't they have the problem? Well, let me show you why they don't have the problem. There's a quite general solution that they use. This is Coulomb electrostatics. Here we have the force density on a charge distribution rho, and here we have Coulomb's law in effect. The Laplacian is equal to minus rho. I'm using some appropriate set of units that Einstein was using at the time. They're called Gaussian units. I don't recall. So why doesn't this have a problem? Well, you just do the sum. You take the force density. It's equal to this term here, drawn directly from that equation. You then take that rho and replace it by the Laplacian. You just plug the field equation, field term in, right? And you end up with this expression here. And then the magic happens. You then do an integration. You then do a differentiation. If this were an integral, this would be the move of integration by parts. But you're just using the product rule of differentiation to turn this expression into this big expression here. Right? And now the key thing is that this whole expression is a divergence. There you've got ddx, right, of something. And that something in there is written as little t, and it is the Maxwell stress tensor for the electric field. Right? So this force density is equal to the divergence of the Maxwell stress tensor, and that's the calculation that shows it. Very simple, very short calculation. Right? So now the rest is pretty easy. If your rigid frame has charges on it, you then calculate the force density as the divergence of the Maxwell stress tensor. You then integrate over all of space with appropriate boundary conditions at infinity, and Gauss's theorem is going to tell you that everything vanishes and you'll be just fine. Right? So that's the calculation. That's the way you get out of the problem. And Einstein is just going to do the same thing now in his new theory. Now, before I move on, I just want to point out something that's going to come back. The middle of the calculation is the writing down of an identity. You take this expression here, and then you throw around the terms just using rules for differentiation, and end up with this term here. And that guy is a mathematical identity. Not a very difficult one. If you know how to differentiate, you can do it. Pretty much do the thing in your head. If you've done field theory, you have done this calculation so many times. You know, it's a very familiar calculation. All right, so Einstein now goes to do exactly the same calculation. But there's a difference. Remember I said there was this funny C term here, right? There it is. That's going to mess up everything. The calculation is not going to work because of that term there. All right, so this is how it goes. You start out, write down the force density on a mass distribution, replace the sigma by the field term, and then expand it all out, you get this term here. You've got an extra bit. It's a big monster. So let me rewrite it for you. I'm rewriting it like this by just relabeling terms. This T here is going to correspond to that guy there. So you'll see that. And then we have this extra bit over here. So you have the force density is the divergence of something that looks like a stress tensor, and this other nuisance part that has to go away. Right? So the solution, the way forward, is that everything is going to be fine if you can make that term go away. Right? And how can you make that term go away? Well, you can just shift it around, move it into the field equations. And that's exactly what Einstein does. Now, before passing on, notice that once again, in the middle of this is a big mathematical identity. It's just a big expansion. Right? That's the calculation you do. Right. So this was the thing that I call version one. I've now written out the expression for the force density. You have a complicated expression for the force density that behaves badly because it doesn't conserve momentum. And you have a nice, simple field equation. Right? Well, it just messed things up a little. So go to version two. You can take this term here and throw a piece of it into the field equation. And then you can use the simplified form of the force density equation. So that's the move. I'm not expecting you to do the algebra in your head, but you know, trust me, it works. It's straightforward. Now the force density is given as the divergence of a stress tensor, and everything has worked out. Einstein's neck has been saved. He published this theory that he knew was wrong, and he's also learned some really important lessons. Let's just reflect on what has just happened here. Some extraordinary stuff has just happened. Okay. Well, the first thing, of course, is that momentum is conserved. Right, the equality of action reaction is saved. So a minimal condition of adequacy of the theory has been restored. Right? If you don't have that, you don't have anything. Now, Einstein started looking at this term here. And once again, if you look at that term, it has a kind of familiar ring to it. And very briefly, Einstein's able to prove that that term corresponds to the energy density of the gravitational field. It's not hard to show. You just move a few masses around and see how the energy moves around. That turns out to be the energy density of the gravitational field. So now what Einstein has is a rather extraordinary outcome. He started out with a vanilla sort of equation, right? And now he has that the Laplacian is equal to a source term that has two parts in it. It has the mass density of ordinary matter, the ordinary lumpy stuff that's around here, and it has the energy density of the gravitational field. So he's got now a democracy of source terms. I mean, think about the way that you would want your gravitation theory to work in a relativistic context. Mass and energy, just different sides of the same coin. Mass produces gravity, so energy produces gravity. There's energy in the field, so the energy of the field must be producing gravity. You expect the energy of the field to be living in the source term. And sure enough, there it is. It's right there in the source term. So it's looking really good, right? This is just the way things look. And another interesting consequence comes out of this. You now have a non-linearity of the gravitational field equations. this is something that that Einstein remarks on later. He wanted nonlinear equations. This is the point at which nonlinear equations actually enter into the story. And then there's one other annoying thing happened. You'll recall that when Einstein had produced his sample gravitational field in that uniformly accelerating frame, the speed of light c varied linearly with distance in the inside the box. That was the homogeneous field. Well, that nice, simple homogeneous field doesn't satisfy this field equation anymore. Right? And so Einstein makes the appropriate remark. He says, the principle of equivalence isn't working. Right? Now, he sort of has a bit of a comeback. He says, well, it sort of works infinitesimally, but it's kind of desperate because, you know, the one case that was supposed to work out well is the case of a homogeneous field. And now he can only say it works infinitesimally in the homogeneous field. I'd like to tell you he was greatly disturbed by this and folded his books and went home. But no, he just didn't really care and just kept going. Right? It was just, oh, well, stick that in a drawer. We'll deal with that another day. All right, so let me move on. So here are the pages in which those calculations appear. I thought, you know, I spent a lot of time looking at these pages. There's the equation I told you. Here's the full stress tensor written out in Einstein's terms. At that time, he was still writing out the equations component by component. It was a slow thing. He hadn't really absorbed Minkowski's methods. It's kind of interesting. He was not using four-dimensional methods at all, which is sort of surprising that late in the game that he would not be doing it. What I want to now do is step back and say there was a method here. Some of you, no doubt, have just said, okay, I get that, that's clear. Some of you are saying, whoa, what happened? There are lots of equations being thrown around. Let me summarize it into a discovery method that Einstein's now found. So this is a way for generating field equations. What you do is first identify an approximation for the field equations you're looking at. So he's got this equation here. This was the version one theory. But then you allow the possibility of higher order correction terms. You don't know exactly what they'll be and whether you'll need them, but you allow for that possibility. Then you have a force equation, force density equation over here. Right? And then you crank the handle of the method to figure out what these higher order terms are going to be. Right? So you combine the two equations by eliminating the source term sigma here using this equation. And you end up with an identity in the field equations only, right? And then you, from that identity, you can read off the exact field equations. Now, it's a little bit of a fudge because you don't know what these higher order terms are, so you kind of have to guess what that identity is. But once you nail that identity, and there aren't too many choices for it, you can then read off what the correct field equation is going to be. Okay, it's a method that you can use. All right, so let's move on now. 1912, 1913. This was the theory that Einstein had published from Prague. He moves to Zurich and he wants to expand. He doesn't want it to be limited just to static gravitational fields. He also wants to extend the covariance of the theory to accelerated motion, things like rotation. Lots of things happen there which I won't be able to talk about now for just running out of time. He starts collaborating with Marcel Grossmann, his colleague from his student days, Marcel Grossmann, the mathematician. This was the guy who gave Einstein the notes that he could study so he could then pass the exams because he'd been cutting classes and hadn't gotten any of them. And if you're interested, we have those notes in the archive. You can see what was there. What comes out of it is this paper, a sketch of a generalized theory of relativity and a theory of gravitation, written in two parts by Einstein and Grossmann. It contains essentially the complete general theory of relativity, but the so-called Einstein field equations are not there. They consider something like the Einstein field equations, but then decide that they're physically unacceptable and go back to square one and try and figure out what the field equations ought to be. So put yourself in Einstein's shoes. At this point, you have a big problem. We now know that if you insist on general covariance and ask what are the simplest equations you can write down, you get driven very quickly to the Einstein field equations. You don't really have that much choice in where you're going to go, maybe a cosmological term, a bit of other tinkering. Right? But Einstein doesn't have that. He doesn't have covariance considerations. Right? But the possibility for the equations are massive. So what's he going to do? He needs a method. Right? Well, you can guess what's happening next. So let me show you. So this is the way the search goes. This is from Einstein's physical part. This is the differential equations of the gravitational field. He sets it up in the very familiar way. He starts out by writing down the field equation for Newtonian theory, and then he asks the question, how can we generalize that into my theory? He's using Greek letters instead of raising indices. So if you see a gamma with a lowercase mu nu, it's actually a G with an uppercase mu nu. That's just a he was fixing up Ricci and Levi-Civita's notation. They had this odd idea that you raise and lower indices for contravariant and covariant components. They didn't want any part of that, so they fixed it. not a good repair. So on the left-hand side, you have the stress-energy tensor of non-gravitational matter, ordinary matter. On the right-hand side, you have the field tensor, the key thing to get. It's going to be the Einstein tensor in the final theory, and it's built out of first and second derivatives of the metric tensor. That's the familiar setup, nothing terribly surprising there. Okay, so now Einstein says, I have a method, right? And in order to be clear on the method I'm going to use, let me give you an illustration of how that method works. And that's laid out here on this page in some detail. Fortunately, I actually don't need to tell you again what the method is, because it's exactly the one that I just described for you. When I describe how Coulomb electrostatic avoids the problem, he's just describing that. I know the equations there are terribly small, so you probably can't read them, but the equations that I've written here are the same equations that he's written over here, and he's now inverting the method. Right? So if you can find this identity in the field quantities, then you can work backwards and read off what the field equation has to be. Of course, in the case of Coulomb electrostatics, you don't get a very exciting outcome. But he's spending a whole page on this, just grinding through, making sure you get the idea. And he says, look, it's just an identity, a very simple identity, this guy here. He even writes down the Leibniz rule for differentiation, just in case you didn't realize that this is just produced by simple mathematical operations. So he then proceeds to go ahead and apply exactly that method. So what's the approximation? Well, the approximation is this, that the field tensor is given by some expression in the second derivatives of the metric tensor, plus further terms that vanish in the first approximation. Right, now that's let me write that in slightly more modern notation. A slightly more modern notation would look like this. The gravitation tensor G mu nu would be written like that. I've raised and lowered indices. Einstein had not yet invented the summation convention, so he's got summations everywhere. So that's the field tensor part. Right. Now what about the force density equation? Well, Einstein had the generally covariant law at this point for the conservation of energy and momentum, which is the divergence of the stress energy tensor. He wrote it out in component terms. He was working very much in component terms here. And so this is the full expression written out in terms of components. The first term here is a coordinate divergence of the stress energy tensor. And then the second term is something that Einstein identifies as a gravitational force density term. And the key thing in it is a derivative of the metric tensor, where the metric tensor is now going to function as some sort of gravitational potential. Right, so that's his force term. So now he has the pieces that are needed for that method that I described for you. And all that now remains is to find the identity. Right? Now he's now playing around with metric tensors, so finding the identity is not a simple job. But it turns out that they can identify one that they believe is unique. And I think years ago I tried to prove that it was unique only if you added extra conditions, but I don't remember. So you're looking for an identity that has this form, a coordinate divergence of something, you don't know what, right? That's going to be equal to a gravitational force density term that is recovered from your GMU. Now you don't know what either of these terms are, right? But you've got to write down a very big identity that looks like that, and then you can read off what those terms are. And so this work is handed over to the Grossman part of the paper. Grossman derives this enormous identity. It's just done in the same way as the earlier ones were done. You just use the product rule for differentiation over and over and over and over and over again until you finally get something that looks like this, right? And then you stop. And that's what they did. They've got that guy there. And then they read off the the expressions for the gravitation tensor and also for the stress energy tensor of the gravitational field. We would now call that the pseudo tensor, but since this theory was not generally covariant, it really wasn't worth fussing over the difference between tensor and pseudo tensor at this point. So you can just read them off here. I won't write down the expressions because they're not terribly illuminating, just a big massive equation. That's the gravitation tensor right there. It's got these four terms. One second derivative term in the metric tensor, and then three terms quadratic in the first derivatives. Kind of the sort of stuff that you would expect. And this is the stress energy tensor of the gravitational field. Now, what I want to emphasize here is the continuity of method. Einstein's doing the same thing all the way through here, from that second theory of 1912. This was the sketch of the method. Identify a first approximation, write down your force density equation, combine them to get an identity, figure out what that identity ought to be. You've got some leeway there, but you keep the identity around until it has the right form, right? And then you can read off the exact field equations. And Einstein's just done exactly the same thing, right? But just elevated up one level. So you identify a good first approximation. That was this expression here in the metric tensor. You get the expression for the force density. You then combine them as best you can into an identity. You have to figure out what the identity is by doing lots of differentiations and regrouping the terms, because you don't know what these higher order terms are. And then you read off the exact field equations. Right. So you get the idea. Guess the rough form of the field equations. Something to do with energy conservation, forces, momentum, blah blah blah, identity, outcomes. Your definite equation is force energy. Now, if you're thinking, boy, that sounds sort of familiar. I've heard that before. I've heard someone do something like that before. Yes, the method that I've just described is in all the textbooks. It's just written slightly differently. So let me show you what the method looks like. It's this. What's your first approximation? Well. You find a tensor. This is now when you're doing modern general relativity. You find a tensor, the field tensor that's built up from the Riemann tensor in appropriate ways. So you get second order derivatives, and typically you say you want it to be linear in the second order derivatives, but you'll take what you get in the first order derivatives. You don't really put in a force density equation anymore. You just take the whole guy. You just take the stress energy tensor. Right? And then you want to figure out what can go in there. Well, you say, well, what identities are there that could be useful? Well, there's the contracted Bianchi identities. They're the guy. Everyone writes down the contracted Bianchi identities, and that's it. And then you read off the field equation. So at this point, what I hope you can see is a continuity of method that starts in 1912 with a very simple case and builds all the way through. Right. So I think that's kind of lovely. All right. So at this point, it would be lovely if we could peer over Einstein's shoulder and watch all of this unfold. Right? Wouldn't it be great? You could sort of sneak into his office and he's sitting there and writing away very quietly, just look over his shoulder and you watch him do all of this. Wouldn't that just be great? Well, we can't do that. We talked about time travel. Yesterday, but no, it's not going to work then. But we can do something that is almost as good. It turns out that the notebook in which Einstein did these calculations has survived. And I can show you some of the pages that match up with what we've just seen. So this is the Zurich notebook. It's been sitting in the Einstein archive. It was labeled by Helen Dukas, Einstein's secretary, Notes for Lecture on Relativity Theory, probably Zurich. So she really didn't know what was there. It goes from two sides on the back, where also Einstein's, which is back, which is front, it's arbitrary. This one says relativity theory in very neat lettering. When you open the inside cover, this is what you see, and I find this to be a wonderful little human perspective on Einstein. Let me invite you to stare at these things and see if anyone, if you recognize any of this stuff. So let me tell you what you're looking at. You're looking at recreational puzzles in mathematics. Right? So this thing down here, as far as I can tell, is a railroad car shunting problem, such as was common in recreational mathematics books at the time. Now, what is this thing here? Well, let me expand it up, and I'll show you what that is. on the left-hand side, you take an 8x8 square, this is on a grid of paper, right, and you're going to chop it up into triangles and rectangles, right, and then you're going to take the triangles and the rectangles, they're sort of marked with squiggly lines, and you're going to move them over to the other side and fill up a rectangle, which is 5x13, right? And so I think you can see there's a problem here, because you've now convinced yourself that these two figures have the same area, because you've cut one up and reassembled it as the other. So you've now proved that 64 is equal to 65. No, just to be clear, no, I don't think that the part of Einstein's corpus is the discovery that 64 is equal to 65. What I do think is he might have been visiting with some children and needed to abuse them. And so he was taking some source material along. Or maybe he was visiting with some adults and he needed to amuse them. It would have amused me. So. This is not his invention, by the way. It's a standard. Okay, so let's move on. I said that at this time Einstein had not used Minkowski's methods until very late. What we have on this page here, an earlier page of the notebook, is Einstein actually working through the formalism of Minkowski. There are no new discoveries here. He's simply writing down Minkowski's formalism, very neat hand, maybe taking notes from a paper somewhere. Just basically like a student exercise. So you've got this sense. This is starting out very early. The notes in this notebook. This is Einstein getting up to speed on four-dimensional methods.
What's the date? The date of the
Sometime in the summer of 1912. You'll have to look in the Einstein papers to get the exact dating. It's now fading out. Presumably, much of it happens after he goes to Zurich, so I think that's August. But some of this stuff could be earlier. So what we have here is an interesting page. Einstein has written down the line element of general relativity. It's written with a capital G. And that's the first time he's ever written this down. Right? It's written the first time with a capital G. And it's the last time it's written with a capital G. Right? So there's Einstein now thinking about a space-time and a space-time geometry. Now, what about that earlier theory of 1912, version 1, version 2? That was all through this, because that was his starting point. He was trying to generalize the theory of 1912, so that was his special case. And do we know that was his special case? Well, it's what he says here. Special case for the G mu nu, or for the G lambda nu. And then he writes down that matrix that I showed you earlier on. He doesn't have minuses here, so the signature's wrong, but okay, maybe he's still thinking ICT, I don't really know. Right, but so that's the special case. Now you might think, oh, that's just a Minkowski metric. No, it's not just a Minkowski metric, because of what happens underneath. What he's writing here is the gravitational field equation of version 2 of the 1912 theory. So what he's saying to himself is, all right, so how do I get this 1912 theory into the bigger space-time formalism. And so these equations I have are now familiar to you. They're the ones we've been staring at for a while. This is just a little by-the-by page that I just happened to love. We stared at this page. A number of us have worked on the Zurich notebook trying to figure out what the hell was in the thing. You stare at that page. What is it about? It was Tillman Zhao who cracked this one to his very great credit. What Einstein's proving here is a minor result in mechanics. If you take a curved surface, ordinary Newtonian mechanics, and you constrain a body to move within the curved surface, and that's the only constraint, that it has to move within the curved surface, what trajectory does it trace out? It traces out a geodesic of the spatial surface. So a body constrained to a surface in Newtonian mechanics moves along the geodesic of the surface, the three-dimensional geodesic of the surface. Now, it's not general relativity, right? You've got to replace space by space-time and do a bit more fiddling, but you can see him homing in on ideas that are going to be important. Okay, we're now fasting forward a lot. The standard story we hear is that Einstein goes to Grossman and says, Grossman, I need help with mathematics. Can you help me? I need something that'll handle these cases. I want general covariance or something like it. Much greater covariance than I have. Grossman goes off to the library, finds the Ricci-Levi-Civita review article on what we now call the tensor calculus of 1901, comes back and, and says to Einstein, "Yes, I've got it, but physicists ought not to mess with this because your equations will come out to be nonlinear." And Einstein says, "Great, that's what I want." Okay, so did that really happen? Is Grossman feeding key results to Einstein in the Ricci-Relativity calculus? Did that really happen? Well, on this page, you can see the Christoffel symbols written down, and then there's the four index symbol, which is in effect the Riemann curvature tensor, and it's written down here. It's an expression for it. On the right-hand side, the words are Grossman tensor for Frank. So this is the moment when Grossman comes to Einstein and says, "Yeah, and the major structure is this four index symbol." And Einstein says, "Okay, I'll let you write that down." And what does Einstein do next? He forms the first contraction, in other words, making the Ricci tensor. Presumably, in a search for the gravitational field equations, cannot get the Newtonian limit out because there are three terms that ought to vanish. Right, if you're going to get the Newtonian limit, and he can't see that they vanish. And how do we know he thinks that those three terms should vanish? Well, that's what the German says, it ought to vanish. So it's not hard to see. These are just the first approximations. So we are very much looking over Einstein's shoulder. Then the whole thing just melts down. I can't go through all the details of it, but I can show you a point at which things get very bad. Einstein is working through certain physical examples. This is the static special case written there, and here you see the stress tensor, right, of the 1912 theory written out in full, and then the fatal words written down here, special case probably incorrect. Right? So Einstein's giving up, he can't get the special case to work. So we wind forward a bit, and on this page, spread over the two pages, Einstein is going through the derivation of an enormous identity in which you produce just by doing multiple derivatives and shuffling terms around and backwards and forwards. And it is, of course, the big term that appears in Grossman's part of the paper. This is the identity that's used to get the field equations of 1913. He's got a little code here, the zeros and the pluses and the crosses. Tell him, you know, keep this term here, move that term over there. If you work through the calculation, you can decode what the symbols mean. Pretty easily. All right, so it's, you know, time's getting on, so let me wind up. I'm not quite finished, but let me just wind up. That's the major part of the content. So Einstein's stuck with a theory that he thinks is okay, but in his bones he knows it's not okay. There are problems with covariance, and he's trying to convince himself that, you know, that maybe they are okay after all. Whole argument, all that sort of stuff happens. Increasing sophistication in his mathematical techniques. He moves to using variational principles instead of the techniques that we saw here. The variational principles are still working in the same way. If you generate field equations from an action principle, you get conservation laws for free. Right? And so it's the same idea. You've got to get the conservation laws to work out. That's going to restrict things massively. Then comes November of 1915 and a slow unwinding. There were a lot of reasons for why he was in trouble earlier on, and he gradually figured out what his problems were, and in the course of a series of famous papers, winds up to the complete general theory of relativity. In the third paper, that's where he gets the quote, explanation of the perihelion motion of Mercury from the general theory of relativity. And that's the moment when he knew he had the right theory. Right, that was the moment. Okay, so if you want more, let me invite you to visit my website. I have a fairly busy website which has lots of stuff on it. Not many people have written about that early story involving the 1912 theory, the corrections to it, and how the method carried forward. A number of years ago, I wrote a paper on this, which is sort of lost in the mist of past. But it's this limited induction as a method of discovery, Einstein's discovery of general relativity. You can download that from my website if you want to just see the equations again and just have me talk you through the details. If you want it at a simpler level, I teach a course called Einstein for Everyone at the University of Pittsburgh, and I've sort of put up a massive online book, right, which is now up to 40 chapters, and it's done without uh, uh, with a, absolute bare minimum of mathematics are basically none at all, and lots of pictures, so you might like that. I also have a thing called the goodies page where I throw up just fun stuff that sort of intrigues me. And one of the things that I realized was there is no popular account of this Zurich notebook anywhere. It's all been written by scholars in my community who are very careful to put in every detail. So it gets massive to try and figure it out. So I put up one. It's a peek into Einstein's Zurich notebook, and it's a very gentle and easy walkthrough, so you can see some of the stuff there. And so we're back with the Zurich notebook, and so if I may, I would like to leave you with something to think about. Right? And so I told you what this was about. That was 64 or 65. I told you what this is about. That was the railroad car shunting problem. Okay. But I didn't tell you what this is about. And I didn't for a very good reason. And the reason is I don't know. And I've said that a lot. What is it about? So if anyone can tell me, I'd be very, very happy to know. You've got the context. These are, it's not going to be, the discovery of the secret of the universe. Right? It's going to be something a little bit simpler. All right, so.
Anything to do with curvature by any chance?
Don't stop. I don't know. So you can ask him, but what can I say? He's not there anymore. So. All right, that's my story, and I think I hit 55 minutes. Was it? Good.
So we have plenty of time for questions.
How could there be? It was so clear.
Well, okay.
It's not a question, but it's a comment that. Puzzle with where you take the thing apart is nowadays known as the infinite chocolate paradox, and YouTube is full of videos of people taking a chocolate bar, 65 squares, chopping it up and putting it back together with one left over.
Oh. Anything to do with chocolate is fine by me, so.
So, great explanation, understand stuff before, so thanks, but I'm a little disappointed by the implication that Einstein was just shuffling equations and something popped out. And I guess the impression that I got of the way he thought was that he was sort of guided by bigger principles and kind of geometric thinking, but you're kind of implying that he's sort of doing just a lot of symbolic manipulations. I mean, what do you think the trade-off or the balance was between just kind of mechanical symbolic manipulation versus being guided by some geometric instinct?
Yeah, well, I've boiled down 8 years of the most creative work of Einstein into a 55-minute talk that I've tried to keep as simple as I can. So I had to miss bits. And there's a great deal more that was going on. He was certainly, you remember at the beginning I said, what are the foundational principles? That was the first bullet point that I had. Yes, he was governed by the earnest need to generalize the principle of relativity to acceleration. That was a big theme for him all the way through. He introduced what he later called Marx's principle. He had the idea that the inertia of bodies would arise somehow through an interaction with other masses. That was guiding him all the way through. And there are certain remarkable points. Those of you who know the rotating disk story, this is where Euclidean geometry pops up for the first time. He explores the geometry that you find if you're on a disk that's rotating in Minkowski spacetime and discovers that the geometry is non-Euclidean. Lots and lots and lots of stuff going on. So yes, if you feel you got a partial picture, you did, but forgive me, I didn't have the time to give a full picture. But I do want to correct one thing. There's this idea nowadays that Einstein was very geometrical here, that the theory was that gravity is a curvature of space-time. This is not the way that Einstein thought about it. Dennis Lamkel has written about this, if I can say, Marco's also thinking about this. Can I point at you and say you also? Yeah, so you can talk to him. He knows a lot about this as well. The very geometrical approach to understanding general relativity is a historical artifact that I think ascended in sometime in the 1960s. There's probably room for some history to be done there, but it really doesn't come until the 1960s. So how did Einstein think? Well, Einstein was a very algebraic thinker. Right? For him, all the thinking was done in terms of equations and formulae and symbols. So if you know the principle of general covariance, it tells you that the equations remained the same as you changed the coordinates. Well, you now would say, of course, you didn't really mean that. No, he meant what he said. The equations have the same form in all coordinate systems because he's spending his time looking at equations. Right? And sometimes, this is one of the big giveaways, sometimes the things that we call coordinates of space-time, he calls variables. And what we call transforming between different coordinate systems, he calls substitution of variables. So if your hope is to find a very modern geometrical type thinker in Einstein, you will never find it. What you will find is a lot of analysis of equations and the forms that the equations take. All right. Perhaps too long an answer.
I have a question which might not be a good question, but let me try anyway. It's about the period where Einstein is first getting worried about conservation of momentum and action of reaction.
Right.
And you said he was thinking about the static gravitational field, and he was thinking about a Newtonian gravitation, and he was thinking about the Coulomb field. And I'm just wondering if there are any issues about action at distance and absolute simultaneity behind those problems. Because if you, of course, in the Newton field, it's actually just the same time as in there, so you're in the Coulomb field.
So could
we think about the problems he was having in terms of that?
I don't think the relative instantaneity issues would come in. What he did, let's pick a slide. Once again, I've simplified because this is complicated stuff. So this is his equation of motion, right? And it has all sorts of the relativistic corrections that are thrown in, and insofar as you have these sorts of correction terms, and you've got to make sure that the q falls inside the time derivative operator, you can't see the q outside, or you're going to get a mess, right? As long as this is the equation that you're working with, which is the equation he was working with, it's clearly not a classical theory. But how do you come to grips with whether equations like that are behaving well? The simplest thing to do is to say, well, there's a special case here. If I just take the case where nothing moves, right? If I just take the case where nothing moves, then the equations collapse down into something that's very much like the Newtonian equations. And so then you can start comparing them across. But you're exactly right. I mean, there's a lot more going on here. This was a sort of an odd theory to get it in more modern terms. It's a theory that looks like this. Issues of relativity and simultaneity are going to come in the orthogonality of these Euclidean spatial slices to certain time-like trajectories. And in the metric here, they appear because you don't have any cross terms, right? You're exactly right. There's a great deal more going on here, and when I worked through this stuff, I mean, I worked through this stuff a long time ago, and I can remember being really lost because Einstein just writes down the equations that you see there, and I had incredible difficulty understanding what was going on. I later on realized why. It's because he's in effect exploring the properties of a space-time that look like that without having the geometric picture that I desperately needed. But this was Einstein. He was better at stuff than me, which I guess I knew.
At what point does a variational principle come in? Did Langchow's by any chance get involved in that?
Here I have to rely on faulty old memory. But I think the first variational principle appears in 1914. In fact, I might even have the front page of the paper in which it appears. it's in this paper here, which is a joint paper with Marcel Rotman. I think it's early 1914. If I remember correctly, it is Bernays who tells him about the value of variational principles. Please don't quote me on this because it's been a long time since I read the Rotman papers. My recollection is Paul Bernays, he thanks Paul Bernays for suggesting, it might even be on that page, no it's not. But it's not hard to guess where the variational principles come from. They're all coming out of Göttingen. You know, that was Hilbert's program, was to turn all of physics into big action principles, and so that's where the idea was originated. And of course, I mean, as you know, if you have a theory of uncertain covariance, and you want to try and figure out what are its covariance properties, an action principle formulation is just wonderful, because now all you need to know is what's the covariance of the action density, a single quantity, as opposed to a big tensorial quantity. So it was just mathematically an excellent way to go. So Einstein was rather at sea doing this, and by the time this paper's written, this is a review article of October 1914. Einstein's very confident in the methods that he's using, and he boasts that first he writes the mathematical part himself, and he boasts that he can now provide derivations himself for much of the stuff. Now, an interesting thing happens here. He's got variation and action principles for his gravitational field equations. They are not generally covariant. And out comes an identity that holds only in the coordinate systems in which his theory obtains. And so that becomes the condition that specifies what he calls adapted coordinate systems. So he knew that there's an identity that holds just within the coordinate systems in which your theory is true. Now, if this is sort of sounding familiar, if you now replace the action density that he's working with by something that will give you a generally covariant theory, right, then that identity is going to turn into the contracted Bianchi identities. So there was some talk in the literature 30 years ago, did he know about it, did he not know about it, to which I answer, it really doesn't matter. Because he understood the formalism well enough to know that if you go to a generally covariant formalism, this is just going to fall out. So don't. Okay.
So for when does the gauge come in? The gauge invariant and did Langhoff come into the picture?
I just don't. Langhoff comes in later. He was, I believe, one of Einstein's assistants. Do you remember Langhoff? The term gauge comes out of Hermann Weyl's stuff. 1918 and later, you know, he's looking for the story. I didn't to tell you, but that's, to my knowledge, that's where the word appears, and then that formalism gets repurposed into modern gauge theory. But if you look at these theories, they all have gauge freedoms, and the gauge freedoms are very important. General covariance is the gauge freedom of Einstein's theory, and Einstein's playing around with this, a lot. That's what the whole idea is all about. Modern reconstruction, so yeah, it's there. It's just not being talked about and addressed in a modern way.
Yeah, I have a question about your claim at the beginning of the talk that Einstein discovered to be a mathematical platonist by working on general relativity.
Yeah.
And there are some people claiming that happened later, so that what Einstein found a good equation, now use the mathematical strategy, but use physical strategy, and he became a mathematical platonist when he was working on unified field theories, and there he was. That was the only way to survive was to be a mathematical platonist, and reconstruct later the story as if. So I think you don't agree with this reconstruction. I would like to.
I wrote a paper on this 15 years ago, and if I could remember what I wrote in the paper, then I'd know whether I wrote it. It means that you think that nature is the realization of the simplest conceivable mathematical ideas, and that you can find the true theories of nature by writing down the mathematically simplest equations. Now, you might think I've just gone loopy there. I was just quoting Einstein. I was just quoting Einstein from the 1933 Herbert Spencer lecture. He says, therefore, in a certain sense, I hold it true that pure thought can grasp reality as the ancients dreamed. That's the last line of the paper. it's pretty strong stuff. At least, look, I might have a couple of words out of place, but that's the gist of it. Yeah. So this is a big story, and it was Ron Van Gogh that ended up writing a dissertation.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there's a lot of work. So those of you who don't know, shall I just briefly tell the story about it, because it's kind of an interesting story. Okay, so Einstein gets into this big mess in 1913. He's basically got the wrong theory. Notice his thinking has been very physical all the way through here. He's not doing anything with any mathematical elegance. We've got to get a Newtonian approximation out. We need energy momentum conservation. Somewhere the principle of equivalence is going to play a role here. Marx's principle is going to play a role. And it just didn't work, right? He ends up with the wrong theory. Meanwhile, Hilbert and Göttingen gets interested and starts writing down what he thinks are the most obvious equations, and he ends up writing down what turns out to be the final equations of general relativity. We now know, because we have the proof pages of Hilbert's 1915 paper, that Hilbert didn't know what he had, because Hilbert then agreed with Einstein that the covariance of the theory had to be limited, and so he started messing up the theory. But he had written down, at some point, at least he'd probably written down what are the final equations. This was a real blow to Einstein, right? And it really shook him. What had happened was that he felt that his methods had led him astray. And he says this in contemporary letters. He says, early on he's saying that mathematics was abstraction, the physical path was the unworkable one. And then very shortly after he says, no, he should have gone with the mathematics. In the first paper of 1915, the November 4th paper, someone, Kachi, you were quoting to me that little passage about the beauty of mathematics. Was that you?
Don't steal my thunder.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Should I stop?
It was November 4th, 1915.
Yeah, but okay, so we'll hear the quote from you about the beauty of mathematics. Okay, all right, so we'll leave it at that. Right, so now, whether at that point he's become a mathematical Platonist or not is a little hard to say. By 1933, it has definitely happened.
Yeah.
Because he writes on the methods of theoretical physics, the Herbert Spencer lecture, and he basically says the way to find a unified field theory, the true theory of nature, is to write down the simplest possible equations, and then you get very, very Platonic talk, although it wasn't Plato's on the other scholar.
Absolutely not.
It was the pseudo
nature was a realization of
nature. Sorry?
Mm-hmm. Plato thought nature could not be a realization of nature, because it wasn't exact.
All right, well, I'll leave you to talk to Elaine about that. Okay. So there was a transition. But the later remarks are very clear. In his autobiographical notes, he says, one thing I've learned from the theory of relativity is that is that you can't get to a theory as complicated as the theory of the unified field, or I think even general relativity. Without using this heuristic.
Yeah, he refers to general relativity too, but some people, one long time people, are claiming that he has reconstructed the story in a different way because he has to justify his own pursuit of the unified field. So I don't know which is the first one.
Anyway, but that's where the literature is. I'll leave you on to figure it out. Sometime he starts talking in fragments like a Platonist immediately after he's got general relativity. By 1933. It's a full-blown treatise, and more importantly, his methods morph over into those that you would expect of a Platonist. His search for the unified field theory is governed by the idea that you write down the simplest equations and see what you can get. And my own feeling is it didn't work very well, right? As far as we can tell, it didn't actually produce anything. The more Platonic he got, the less productive he became as a physicist. I mean, productive in the sense of producing discoveries that we now affirm as being valuable. Did I say enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's awesome.
Huh? I'm trying to get shorter.
Can this method for generating field equations be used recursively? Because it takes as input something you think is a first approximation.
Right.
And then you want to find higher order terms. And then you end up with something at the end. Yeah, can I just say, can I start over again and say, well, I think this is a first approximation plus some other higher order terms that I want to find out about?
No. Was that short enough?
Yes.
My first hunch is no, it isn't going to work, but wouldn't it be lovely if it did? But no, I suspect not. But if you can see a way, I mean...
Let me think. I haven't thought about this. So
if you had said yes, I was going to ask you for an example.
Ask him. He's cooking it up right now. You can see.
I think there's something that you can do in the direction of post-Newtonian approximations. Mm-hmm. But there we already know the full theory, but I know that some people are cooking it up without coming down from Einstein theory, but they're going up from Newton's theory.
Do you actually have an example of somebody doing PPM without having, independently of having a GR?
I think there are some examples in cosmology, but I would have to look carefully.
That is a really surprise.
Yeah. But you see, I want to go up from here. I want to know what the correction is here. I have time for the equations.
I don't know. We understand.
Yeah.
It was time.
Yes. We have still 10 minutes.
Completely changing the subject. How distinctive was Einstein's approach that you described earlier in your talk? So the whole question of whether there could simply just be a Lorentz programming version of Newtonian gravity and why that didn't work.
Well, you're saying it was very distinctive. 1905, he builds a special theory of relativity on the postulate that the speed of light is an invariant. In 1907, he's saying, well, not always, right? The speed of light changes, you know, with gravitational fields, and he got a lot of heat from that from Max Abraham, who was quite a colorful character and had no reservations about telling people what he thought, and which caused him a lot of personal trouble, by the way. So the way the history normally goes is we focus in on Einstein. He launches off with the principle of equivalence. There are a whole bunch of ideas there that don't pan out in the end. Marx's principle was very important. Generalizing the principle of relativity was very important to him. Nowadays, we had, 20 years of work in philosophy of space and time, gradually realizing that a lot of this doesn't work the way that he said, right? He abandoned Marx's principle. We can't really find a sense in which the principle of relativity has been generalized in the general theory of relativity, et cetera. It's a big story. But so what about the other approach? Right? What if you say, okay, I'm not going to do anything crazy. I'm just going to go for a Lorentz covariant theory of gravity and just keep it as conservative and simple, minimal changes. A number of people were doing that. Abraham was having a go at it. He was actually, I think, giving up special relativity in the process. I mentioned Poincaré, Minkowski. The important one was Gunnar Nordström. Gunnar Nordström started to develop the natural generalization. So you start out with a scalar potential, you write them in the Dalembertian, the scalar potential is equal to the source density, and then you start tinkering, and you have to keep making adjustments. So Einstein got onto this and started collaborating with Nordström. This was a little endeavor on the side. And gradually things morphed and morphed and morphed. So one of the big moves that happens is Nordström had started out using the mass density as the source term. What Einstein knows through the work of Lauer is that the rest mass density is the wrong guide. You need to use the trace of the stress energy tensor, and then certain energy theorems work out very well. But the moment you use the trace of the stress energy tensor as your source term, then the fact that a body is stressed is going to be producing the gravitational effect. And when you start to incorporate all of these effects into the Nordström theory, the theory gets to be crazier and crazier and crazier. So by 1914, you have a theory that is isomorphic to a space-time that in modern terms is geometrically, is only conformally flat. And the conformal factor stuck out the front becomes Nordström's gravitational potential. Right? So now, of course, the guy who's doing this work is actually Einstein. So Einstein and Fokker in early 1914 have this wonderful paper where they show that if you take the conservative route, follow Nordstrom's theory, develop it, it turns into a theory that is merely conformally flat. Formal parameter is the gravitational potential. But the best part is what there's a single field equation for that, and the single field equation is, right, curvature scalar is equal to trace and stress energy tensor, right, which of course looks just like the collapsed Einstein field equations. So there was a sense that no matter what pathway you follow, you're going to end up with something like like general relativity. And there are more recent papers, I guess I should say, that give similar analyses. One of the key moves you saw in 1912 was that the energy density of the gravitational field becomes one of the sources, right? So you could have an iteration where you start out with a linear equation, discover you've got energy in the field, put that in the source, that changes the equation, and cycle around. Just following that through, you end up with the Einstein equations. So, I think there's a sense, I sometimes hear relativists saying this, that there's a sense that Einstein's theory came too early. Right, there were more conservative pathways that would get there, and these are the more conservative pathways that people, I guess, are thinking of. So.
We have time for another question.
Einstein, of course, had this remarkable intuition, but he probably had a reason why he did not take dy c by dy t, because you have dy c by dy x, dy c by dy y, dy c by dy z. Gravitational potential, but the moment you take dy c by dy t, I think the physical intuition and everything would get really messy. Do you have any?
Sorry, I'm. What are the quantities that you're
dy c by dy t. If you have the expression you had,
which one?
The variation of the Minkowski type, right in the beginning you had.
Oh, sure. Okay, let's go there. Oh, you mean if he has cross terms in the line element?
Line element, dy c by dy t.
Yeah, okay.
So the fundamental reason probably he had
permitted
to take dy c by dy t.
Yeah, why he doesn't have cross terms here, yeah. Yeah, they pop up, of course, when you go to a rotating frame of reference. Yeah. Well, this was actually very bad luck for Einstein that this happened. If you know the geometry of this, if this C depends linearly on a coordinate system, you're just in Rindler coordinates for a Minkowski spacetime, so it's very simple. And so, but the awkward thing about that is two things happen. First, it looks like all of the variability that you want to attach to gravity lives in the G00, which it doesn't, right? That's going to cause, that caused a lot of trouble. And the other part is that it looks like space is staying Euclidean, which it isn't going to. And so in a nutshell, you can see exactly what the problems were. This is the basis of why he didn't get the gravitational field equations in 1913, because he expected that sort of behavior to come out, right? And, given what he knew at the time, you can't fault him for not realizing just how messy it was going to get.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, let's take a 15 minutes for coffee.
Okay.